I guess it's that time, huh? Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Bottom Line Group. This is a closed meeting of Alcoholics Anonymous. We ask that you silence your cell phones at this time and please refrain from cussing when you share. Look, they still spelled cussing wrong. It's cursing. I guess that's a northern thing. When you share, there's a map. Wait a minute. When you share, there is a map on the door showing available parking. Please do not park in the largest lot behind this building, which is where I'm parked. No, I'm just kidding. Just cut your wheels real sharp. They won't be able to get you out of there, trust me. They'll be out there farting with it for 30 minutes trying to get it out of the parking lot. In support of AA's singleness of purpose, attendance at closed meetings is limited to persons who have a desire to stop drinking. If you think you have a problem with alcohol, you're welcome to attend this meeting. We ask that when discussing our problems, we confine ourselves to those problems as they relate to alcoholism. Please join in a moment of silence followed by the serenity prayer. God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. I'm an alcoholic and a member of this group. My name's Doug.
Hey, Doug.
Alcoholics Anonymous is a fellowship of men and women who share their experience, strength, and hope with each other that they may solve their common problem and help others to recover from alcoholism. The only requirement for membership is a desire to stop drinking. There are no dues or fees for AA membership. We're self-supporting through our own contributions. AA is not allied with any sect, denomination, politics, organization, or institution. Does not wish to engage in any controversy, neither endorses nor opposes any causes. Our primary purpose is to stay sober and to help other alcoholics to achieve sobriety. They got a whole bunch of directions up here, but you know what? I think I'm just going to wing it. This is a big book meeting. Last week we did, actually it was the last 2 weeks. The week before that we did the first list of the fourth step, which was the resentment list. Last week we did the second list of the fourth step, which was the fears list. And I'm going to review them real quick. And it's real simple. It won't take but a minute. It's a big book meeting, and we're currently reading in the big book the directions for how to do the steps. And one of the things I got to tell you is from my own experience, which is the only thing that I can really share with any of you guys, is my experience with the steps. And one of the things that I experienced early on in my sobriety, which was back in around 90, 91 when I first got sober, was that somehow when I went to meetings, in the air was this feeling, this... It was just there, that's all I can tell you, was that you just simply don't discuss the steps in meetings because somehow it was between you and your sponsor, and it was just something we didn't talk about in meetings. And I remember going to step meetings and there literally being no concept, no conversation, no actual detailed look at what the steps were until I went to the seminar in like 98 or 99 did I actually go to a meeting in which they actually went to the book and said, this is what it says and this is what it means. And this is what you're expected to get from it. And it was real simple, you know. But I heard things that sounded like this. They said, you know, you could ask 10 different people how to work the steps, and you're going to get 10 different answers. And then I later heard somebody say, well, yeah, you just asked the wrong 10 people, and that's all there is to it. Because the steps are simple, and the precise directions for what to do are right here in the big book. And they're not in the 12 and 12, and they're not in any of the other literature that we have. There were years that I thought the big book was just a description of Alcoholics Anonymous, and the directions for how to do the steps was in the 12 and 12. Because when I opened the 12 and 12, it confused the hell out of me, and it still does, I got to tell you. There's still a lot of things in there, and I'll tell you what, I'm not going to leave you hanging and wondering what the hell I'm talking about. In the 12 and 12, they mention the seven deadly sins, but they tell you absolutely nothing whatsoever to do with it. They don't tell you to write it down. They don't tell you to apply any spiritual solutions to it. They don't tell you to, well, just don't be greedy. Just don't be full of sloth. Just don't, what are the others, kill or whatever. You know, I don't, whatever the seven deadly sins are, I really don't pay any attention to that stuff. But I just, you know... All I can tell you is a lot of that stuff, you know when you're eating too much, you know when you're sleeping too much, you know, and to hell with the rest of that. But when you're reading the 12 and 12, and it's just like that with many of the other topics in there, when they tell you about something, it's just vague descriptions and vague references to something. They don't do like they do in this book. And in this book, it's real simple. The whole idea is very simple. And the idea of what the steps are trying to do is this. They're trying to tell you that alcohol is not what's wrong with us. Alcohol is only a symptom of an underlying problem, and that is in the third step. The third step, the end of the third step, is on page 64, right there at the top. And they're going to give us a description of what we're going to do in the fourth step here. If you guys got books, I didn't pass them out. I was talking. Wow, they even changed the place for the. Man, some people just ain't happy with anything, are they? Anyway, the books are over here now, and if there's any up there, I don't know. Anyway, at the top of page 64, it says about the third step, a personal house cleaning, which many of us had never attempted, though our decision was a vital and crucial step, the decision of the third step to turn our will and our lives over to the care of God as we understood Him. Though our decision was a vital and crucial step, it could have little permanent effect unless at once followed by the fourth step, which it says is a strenuous effort to face and be rid of the things in ourselves which had been blocking us. Our liquor was but a symptom, so we had to get down to causes and conditions. This is what they're talking about, the fourth step here. We're going to get down to the causes and conditions of why I drank, okay? That's what the fourth step is. It's a strenuous effort to face and be rid of the things in ourselves which are blocking us. And once again, blocking us from doing what? God's will. In the third step, it says, I made a decision to turn my will and my life over to the care of God as I understood Him. And basically, what that says in English, it says, I'm going to do what God wanted me to do. I'm going to stop doing what I wanted to do all my life, which was self-centered. I'm going to get this. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. I'm going to live my life for myself. And now I'm going to do what God wanted me to do, which is to serve the people that are in this world. I heard somebody say, yeah, it's to serve God and to do God what God wants you to. But it's what God wants you to do is real simple, because I went to some of the smartest guys. I didn't know that for years. And he said, one of the smartest guys I run across said, look, you know, God does things for people. He did something for me. When I came into Alcoholics Anonymous, there was somebody there. And he said something and helped me through the steps and showed me the way. And that's how God came to me, was through somebody else, okay? And that's exactly the way it's going to work with me from now on. Not just to show people how to find the faith in God through these steps, but there's a lot of other things you can do for people. I mean, some people have never really experienced love in their life. Personally, I have. I mean, I don't mean sex. I mean love. I mean someone who genuinely cares for someone else and cares about their well-being. I personally grew up with grandparents and parents who genuinely cared for me, and I felt it. But I have met some people in my life who said that they just never experienced that. No one in their life has ever actually showed them that. So, you know, why couldn't that be part of my job in life, is to show other people that I actually genuinely care for them, you know, and I'm concerned about them. And so what we're talking about here is to face and be rid of the things in ourselves which are blocking us from doing that, okay? Blocking me from doing things for other people, because I made a decision to turn my will and my life over to the care of God, which is God needs me to do things for other people. I've made a decision to do things for other people. And that's the whole idea behind this, is that the two things that we're going to be talking about here don't occupy the same space, and that is selfishness and self-centeredness, back in the third step. Selfishness and self-centeredness is the root of my troubles, and the key to freedom from this, which is the core of alcoholism, is selfishness and self-centeredness, driven by 100 forms of fear. And if you think that that's my opinion, that's on page 62, at the beginning of the first full paragraph at the top right there. Selfishness and self-centeredness that we think is the root of our troubles, driven by 100 forms of fear. So alcoholism is not the problem. Selfishness and self-centeredness is the problem. And the key to being free of this selfishness and self-centeredness is to be the exact opposite of that, which is selfless and having faith. We're saying that this is self-centered fears that we're going to be talking about here when we get into the fourth step a little better here in a minute. So to be free of self-centered fears, I'm going to be selfless and think about others and have faith in God. It's the exact opposite of it, okay? Now, when someone says something like that to me and I understand it, I say, yeah, I believe that. I think that's the way out. I can't just get up the door and get up and walk out the door and go out and do it because I don't know how. That's all there is to it. All my life I've been selfish and self-centered, and I really have no idea how to think about other people and do things for other people. I have to be taught in that sense. And what these steps are going to do is they're going to help me learn. They're going to teach me how to stop thinking about myself, because it's going to put me in a much better position to start thinking about other people and doing things for other people. And remember, it doesn't say this anywhere in the book, but I firmly subscribe to it. My first sponsor told me, he said, you know what these really are? They're 12 steps to growing up. They're 12 steps to going from the child, the selfish, self-centered, full of fear child that I was, to this adult that I'm looking to become, which is this selfless giving, and I have faith in God now. I have faith that God's going to take care of everything. All I got to do is worry about what He intended me to do all along, instead of my own little selfish, whatever it was that I was on, my life. You know, I know where that got me. Selfish and self-centeredness got me to the end of my rope. I don't know about you guys, but I was at the end, without a doubt. So, we went through, there's four lists in the fourth step. The four lists are, the first one being resentment is the number one offender. The second list is fears. These are the four common manifestations of self, and it says that right here on the same page we were just on a minute ago, 64, within the beginning of the fourth step, it says, about the fourth step, first, we searched out the flaws in our makeup which caused our failure, and I'm going to add this, our failure to do God's will, because that's what, in the third step, I made the decision to do God's will, remember? And someone, you know, there were years when I didn't fully understand a lot of the steps, and I thought that somewhere in the third step, there was this act of turning my will and my life over to the care of God. Because I used to hear people in meetings, because I guess I was hanging around people that just didn't know, okay? And that's all there was to it. I was listening to people share in meetings who had no idea what they were talking about, and it really didn't help me out much. And what they said was that somehow the third step was the act of turning my will and my life over to the care of God. That somewhere in there, I was expected to learn how to do that. And then later on, I heard somebody say what it really meant. What it meant was, made a decision to turn my will and my life over to the care of God as I understood Him, meant I'm going to do 4 through 12. It's 4 through 12 that are going to teach me how to do this. It's not somehow in the third step I'm going to learn how to do it. It's the decision to go on with the rest of the steps. And that's pretty much how simple that is. But we searched out the flaws in our makeup which caused our failure to do God's will. I said I made the decision to do God's will, so that's a pretty much a statement of fact that I haven't been doing it up till now. I haven't been on that path. So I'm going to search out the flaws in the fourth step in my makeup which caused my failure to do God's will, being convinced that self manifested in various ways. I'm in the middle of page 64 here if you guys didn't. Being convinced that self manifested in various ways was what had defeated us, we considered its common manifestation. So that's where I get that from. I got that from somebody else, but that's where it says it in the book here. It says we're going to look for the common manifestations of self in the fourth step. And those four things, and we're going to find them here in a minute, the four common manifestations of self are resentment, fear, selfishness, and dishonesty. Now, in the selfishness and dishonesty, how we find that, we don't make a list of selfishness and we don't make a list of dishonesty. We make a list of harms done others, and that's what we're going to be talking about tonight. Because last week we did the resentment list, and no, it was 2 weeks ago we did the resentment list. Last week we did the fears list, which is a real simple list. You know, you just write down what it is you're afraid of and understand that all those fears are self-centered fears. Once again, selfishness, self-centeredness, that we think is the root of our troubles, driven by 100 forms of fear. Okay, that's what we're calling this thing. And all resentment is based in fear, too. That was one of the things that took me a long time to come to terms with. I mean, I don't know, I can't really put my finger on why. Maybe I was, I don't know, just wrestling with it, I guess. I thought there must be some kind of justified anger in my life. There's got to be, you know. You trying to tell me that under no circumstances is there a justified anger? It's not the point. The point is that to understand that that is based in fear, okay? That every time I get mad about something, there's something that I'm afraid of. And that was real hard for me to come to terms with. But I've come to terms with it now. I believe that. And when I see somebody with rage in their face, you know what I see? I see somebody with fear. That's what I've never seen that before. I used to always, I felt fear when I had seen somebody with rage. And I'd pump up real, Let's have a shouting match, okay? Now I see fear, and it's a whole different ballgame. A lot of times I can even put my finger on what fear it is, even though it's in somebody else. I go, I see it right away. I got the same thing. It's right here in me, too. But so today we're doing the harms done others list, and we're going to start with the end of the fears list. It says, it's on page 68, down at the bottom, the first half paragraph. It's like part on this page and part on the next. And it says, now about sex. Okay. Now, I used to think that this was all about the sex inventory, but that really it doesn't. I'll show that to you when we get to the end of the chapter here. It's only another couple of pages, like one and a half pages. I'll read it real quick here. Just stay with me here. Now about sex, many of us needed an overhauling there, but above all, we tried to be sensible on this question. It's so easy to get way off track here. Oh, here we find human opinions running to extremes, absurd extremes perhaps. One set of voices cry that sex is a lust of our lower nature, a base necessity of procreation. Then we have the voices who cry for sex and more sex, who bewail the institution of marriage, who think that most of the troubles of the race are traceable to sex causes. They think we do not have enough of it, that it isn't the right kind. They see its significance everywhere. One school would allow man no flavor for his fare, and the other would have us all on a straight pepper diet. We want to stay out of this controversy. We do not want to be the arbiter of anyone's sex conduct. We all have sex problems. We'd hardly be human if we didn't. What can we do about them? Now, here is the directions. This next little sub-paragraph, sort of a small little paragraph here. This one little spot is the direction for this part of the fourth step inventory. How do you know that? Is because he says at the end of it, he says, we put this all down on paper and looked at it. Now, look what he says. He's got some question marks here that we need to answer these questions in. He says, we reviewed our conduct over the years past. Where had we been selfish and dishonest? Remember, those are the two that we're looking for. And if you're wondering how I picked out those two, because he also says, inconsiderate, did we unjustifiably arouse jealousy, suspicion, or bitterness? Where were we at fault? What should we have done instead? We got this all down on paper and looked at it. Okay. Now, how I know that those selfish and dishonest are the only two that we're really going to pick out of there for the later on in the inventory, in the 10th and the 11th step inventories. Just go out to the 10th and the 11th step real quick. It don't take but a minute. It's about there on page 84 at the bottom. Right after the promises of the 9th step is the 10th step on page 84. Right in the middle of the page, he says, this thought brings us to step 10, which suggests we continue to take personal inventory. Now go down about 10 more lines, and he says, this is not an overnight matter. It should continue for our lifetime. This fourth step inventory is for the past, and the 10th step inventory is the exact same inventory. There's no difference in them. He says, continue to watch for selfishness, dishonesty, resentment, and fear. He doesn't go on to say jealousy and bitterness and suspicion and in consideration. He's only popping out these four here. He's saying that these are the four common manifestations of self that we need to stay on top of for the rest of our lives. Selfishness, dishonesty, resentment, and fear. When these crop up, and here's all the other steps in step 10. That was four. Continue to watch for selfishness, dishonesty, resentment, and fear. When these crop up, we ask God at once to remove them. That's 6 and 7. We discuss them with someone immediately. That's step 5. We make amends quickly if we've harmed anyone. That's steps 8 and 9. All those other steps are right there. So what step 10 is today, tomorrow, and from now on, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9 are the past. They're to clean up the wreckage of our past. But we're going to take from this knowledge that we now have of how to be free of these four common manifestations of self, and we're going to apply them to our lives every day from now on. Okay? Go back to step 4 back here. And one of the things that I had to question about was, it doesn't say that this is an inventory of harms done others. It just says, now about now about sex. Many of us needed an overhauling there. He says, we all have sex problems. We'd hardly be human if we didn't. What can we do about them? We reviewed our own conduct over the years past. He doesn't really give us this idea that we're making a list of all the people that we had harmed, okay? But there's sort of a slight contradiction here when you go to the end. Here, we'll go ahead and read to the end here. In this way, we tried to shape a sane and sound ideal for our future sex life. We subjected each relation to the test. Was it selfish or not? We asked God to mold our ideals and help us to live up to them. We remembered always that our sex powers were God-given and therefore good, neither to be used lightly or selfishly, nor to be despised or loathed. Whatever our ideal turns out to be, we must be willing to grow toward it. We must be willing to make amends where we have done harm, provided that we do not bring about still more harm in doing so. I think what he's saying there is you can't save your ass at the expense of somebody else. You can't tell your wife you slept with her best friend because, you know, her best friend is now going to be very angry, and so is, you know, they're never going to speak to each other again. You can't do something like that because it just doesn't work like that. You still feel guilty, remorseful, and shameful about what it is that you've done now that you've thrown somebody else under the bus to save yourself. In other words, we treat sex as we would any other problem. In meditation, we ask God what we should do about each specific matter. The right answer will come if we want it. God alone can judge our sex situation. Counsel with persons is often desirable, but we let God be the final judge. We realize that some people are as fanatical about sex as others are loose. We avoid hysterical thinking or advice. Suppose we fall short of the chosen ideal and stumble. Does this mean we're going to get drunk? Some people tell us so, but this is only a half-truth. It depends on us and our motives. If we are sorry for what we have done and we have the honest desire to let God take us to better things, we believe we will be forgiven and will have learned our lesson. If we are not sorry and our conduct continues to harm others, we are quite sure to drink. We are not only theorizing, these are the facts out of our experience. Now remember, when they say we are not theorizing, these are the facts out of our experience, they're talking about we, the first 100, the first 100 who wrote this book, or co-wrote it, supposedly. Somebody told me it was Bill who pretty much wrote it, but he wanted to include everybody else, so he wrote the we's in there all the time instead of I. To sum up about sex, we earnestly pray for the right ideal, for guidance in each questionable situation, for sanity, and for the strength to do the right thing. If sex is very troublesome, we throw ourselves to the harder into helping others. We think of their needs and work for them. This takes us out of ourselves. That's pretty much the whole basis of this recovery thing right here. The basis of the idea of selfishness and self-centeredness is the root of our troubles, and we think of their needs and work for them. This takes us out of ourselves is the solution, the solution to alcoholism. When someone sets a drink down in front of me and says, would you like to have a drink? How I react to that, do I say yes or do I say no, is based solely on whether I'm still thinking about myself or whether I'm doing and thinking about other people. And that's the whole idea here. I believe that because it's happened for me. I've been in many situations when I would have normally drank over the last 15 years. And when I hear people come in here and say, you know, hey, I got 15 years of sobriety, and whew, boy, I had a close call out there. All I can say is, dude, I don't know what you're doing, but it's not what I'm doing because I don't have close calls. I haven't had a close call since I got sober in 1990. And all I can tell you is it must have came from this, because I was a lunatic for years. I had 5 years of crack under my belt and at least 13 years of drinking alcoholically before I got sober. So I am a real alcoholic. I've even had people say, well, maybe you're not a real alcoholic. Well, you don't know me, pal, because I was sleeping in the woods over here and everything was just fine, okay? I'm a real alcoholic, and I have been relieved of my alcoholism, and I believe this, okay? If we have been thorough about our personal inventory, we have written down a lot, okay? We have listed and analyzed our resentments. We have begun to comprehend their futility and their fatality. We have commenced to see their terrible destructiveness. We have begun to learn tolerance, patience, and goodwill toward all men, even our enemies, for we look on them as sick people. That's the spiritual solution to resentments, is forgiveness. For we look on them as sick people. That's how to forgive right there. Let me go back and I'm going to talk about that in just a minute. We have listed the people we have hurt by our conduct. You see there? He's saying that we've made a list of people that we have hurt by our conduct. He's not just saying the sexual list. Even though when you go back to the directions for how to make this list of harms done others and harms done others sexually, that's probably something I haven't mentioned right now, but there are four lists. And although this is only like the third one we're looking at, I like to call it either list 3A and 3B or list 3 and 4. However you want to look at it, there's going to be four lists here. The resentment list, the fears list, and the harms done others sexually list, and the harms done others list. The reason being is, when you get out to the eighth step is only one sentence. The eighth step is speaking in a past tense. They're telling me, they're telling each and every one of us that we've already got this list, and that's exactly what it says. We have listed, back to where I was just reading on 70, we have listed the people we have hurt by our conduct and are willing to straighten out the past if we can. He doesn't say only the sexual harms that we've done others. He says we've listed the people we have hurt by our conduct. In this book, you read again and again that faith did for us what we could not do for ourselves. What he's saying there is, I turned a drink down. When someone offered me a drink, I said, no thanks, I've had enough. You don't want me drinking, trust me. I'll be leaving here with your car and your wallet, and I probably won't come back for a couple of months or something. Did for us what we could not do for ourselves. We acted sanely when someone offered us a drink. We acted sanely when the time came up. When I had a pocket full of money on Friday and no one knew, and I could have stopped in, I said, no. It'll only be one. That's how many times have I heard that? I got to tell you, that was a pretty much a weekly experience for me. No one will know. And then 3 days later, everybody knew, you know. We hope you are convinced that now God can remove whatever self-will has blocked you off from Him. That's the whole idea behind the fourth step. We hope you are convinced now that God can remove whatever self-will has blocked you off from Him. If you have already made a decision, the third step, and an inventory of your grosser handicaps, the fourth step, you have made a good beginning. That being so, you have swallowed and digested some big chunks of truth about yourself. Now, once again, it doesn't really separate and say that you're going to make two lists here. It doesn't say that you're going to make a harms done others list and a harms done others sexually list. It just says that you're going to make a sex inventory. But when you go out to step 8, and step 8 is on like, 70. Right there with 6 and 7. 6 and 7 are on page 76. And on page 76, the 8th step is only one sentence. He says, now we need more action. In the middle of the page here, on page 76, is step 8. Now we need more action, without which we find that faith without works is dead. Let's look at steps 8 and 9. Here's step 8. It's one sentence. We have a list of persons, of all persons we have harmed. It doesn't just say sexually. He says we have a list of all persons we have harmed and to whom we are willing to make amends. We made it when we took inventory. And that's step 8. That's all there is to it. We subjected ourselves to a drastic self-appraisal. Now we go out to our fellows to repair the damage done in the past. Now he's going to begin talking about the next, I guess it's the next 9 pages are the directions for how to make amends. And but anyway, that's what I'm showing you here is what I understood as a definite explanation that there are two lists there. That is not just a list of harms done others sexually. Because the resentment list is not a list of harms done others. It's not a list of people that we had harmed, our resentment list. Because some of these people don't even know we're mad at them. I mean, you just walk around mad at them all the time, and unless you did something to harm them, then it's not going to be on both lists. You know, it's going to be the resentment list and on the harms done others list. But most of the people that I'm angry with don't even know that I'm angry with them because I haven't really acted it out. I haven't keyed their car or flattened their tires or anything stupid like that. So they don't even know. But, so the harms done others, back to the page where the list is at. I'd like to quote it to you, but I'm going to have to flip pages here. He just says sex. Right at the middle of the page on 69. We all have sex problems. We'd hardly be human if we didn't. What can we do about them? And starting with this we, this is the directions for the making this list here. Okay. We reviewed our own conduct over the years past. Where had we been selfish and dishonest? Now, what someone told me is you're going to start by making these names. You're going to start by writing down all the names of the... My sponsors had me write down my family. Write down your grandparents, your parents, your sister, your brother, your cousin, your uncle, and then start and then come down with your ex-wives or ex-wife, your ex-girlfriends, current girlfriends, whoever it is, these people that I have harmed. And my first sponsor just had me write down everybody's name. He didn't even say single out which ones it was that you harmed. He said write all their names down because you pretty much hurt them all. I mean, that's what he told me. So I pretty much had a list of every single person that I had come in contact with, including my employers, you know, of 6 months or a year, or it's the guy I worked for 5 years or something. All their names were on there. And then this is the questions that I asked. After I wrote down all their names, I answered these questions with those names. I said, where had I been selfish? Where had I been dishonest? Where was I inconsiderate? Whom had we hurt? That was the first of the questions to answer, was whom had we hurt? Put the names down. Did we unjustifiably arouse jealousy, suspicion, or bitterness? That would definitely be in the relationship category of those, you know, my ex-girlfriends or ex-wife would be whom, I mean, did I unjustifiably arouse jealousy, suspicion, or bitterness? Where were we at fault? What should we have done instead? We got this all down on paper and looked at it. Now, the reason for this is once again to see where self had taken me, to see that I had hurt these people out of selfishness and that I was not thinking of their well-being. I was thinking of myself, what I could get from people, you know, just lying and stealing and cheating. And was that Pac-Man? I haven't played Pac-Man in a long time. Okay, so I like to tell my sponsees that this really is the biggest list of the four, okay? The harms done others sexually. And someone once said, I don't remember who, I think it was Joe and Charlie, said, you're going to break them down into two lists, harms done others sexually and harms done others, you know, just harms done others, because the harms done others sexually are the closest relationships to us, and this whole shebang is all about relationships with other people. And getting in the right place in those relationships is going to be a giving person in those relationships instead of a taking person, you know. I don't mind receiving from people who are giving, you know, but it's not really my purpose for being there anymore. I don't want to turn down someone else's help to me or someone else's whatever it is, you know, giving their time or their present or something like that for birthday or Christmas. Don't want to turn that stuff down because, you know, you can hurt somebody's feelings that way too. But my main reason for being in those relationships is now the opposite, is to give and to serve and to do for those people instead of taking and getting and you know, expecting. And in order to get to that place, I have to first see where I wasn't at that place, okay? And the other reason for making this list here is because, remember, we're talking about the spiritual solution. This is not just a search for negativity. This is not just a morbid search to find where I was wrong in all these places and I was just evil and bad and oh, woe is me. No, this is to, this, it says it right in the beginning of the fourth step here. This is to a strenuous effort to face and be rid of the things in ourselves which had been blocking us from doing God's will. I made a decision to do God's will, and now I'm going to face and be rid of the things that kept me from doing it. Okay? Within this fourth step is outlined how to forgive. I see them as if they were perhaps spiritually sick. They weren't thinking about what God wanted them to do, or they wouldn't have cut me off on the freeway. They wouldn't have broke into my house and stole my stuff, you know? And they wouldn't have crashed two big airplanes into our buildings up there and knocked them down if they were spiritually fit. I mean, whose God tells them to do something like that, you know? I don't think God told us to go over there and drop bombs on their heads. We just did that on our own. I saw a good bumper sticker today, and it said, it was a brand new, I think it was, anyway, it said, man, it was good. It said, only God can judge the terrorists. It's our job to arrange the meeting, signed U.S. Marine Corps. I thought about that for a couple of miles. That was pretty good. So I said that because I had a resentment for like 6 months against all them people over there until I finally said, you know what? I'm thinking about this like 2 hours every day, how I just can't wait to see the bombs falling out of them B-52s or something, you know? And I finally said, you know what? I've been carrying this around for like 6 months and went right over my head. I mean, snuck up behind me, you know. 6 months worth of blocking me off from God's will, and I didn't even know it. I just wanted to share that with you because stuff sneaks up on me, too. It doesn't matter how much time you got. It's right there on top of me. So the other reason for making this list is not just to see that I am selfish and self-centered, because that's one of the parts of the fourth step, is to convince me. The first requirement is that we be convinced that any life run on self-will can hardly be a success. And the other reason for making this list is because we're going to get the names that are our eight-step list. Remember that the eight-step is speaking in a past tense. It's saying we already have this list. We made it when we took our inventory. That's exactly what it said. So this is where you're going to get those names, not from the resentment list. We don't need to make amends unless it's in both categories. My sponsees that I've had over the years have brought that question to me. They say, so I'm going to make amends to the people that I have resentments against? Not unless you've done harms to them. I mean, having a resentment against somebody, I don't really believe that falls into the category of harms done others, unless you actually took action and did something to... because I was mad at them, I did something to get even with them or something, then it falls into both of them. It's the resentment list and the harms done others list, and I have to make amends for what I did. But the resentment list is for the spiritual solution of forgiveness. I must forgive those people for what I think they did, because the time that I spend being angry with those people for blowing up, running those airplanes into those buildings is time that I am not thinking about what God wants me to do. I spent 2 hours yesterday thinking of how I just can't wait to see those B-52 bay doors opening up and the bombs just spilling out of the bottom. I spent 2 hours thinking about that, and I was not thinking, what does God want me to do here and now in my life, you know, and where I'm at today. So that's the whole idea, is once again what he's saying here, and the spiritual solution for resentments, he says, for when harboring such feelings, we shut ourselves off from the sunlight of the Spirit, the insanity of alcohol returns, and we drink again, and with us to drink is to die. So that's the whole idea behind being free of resentments, is it's harboring such feelings shuts me off from the sunlight of the Spirit. Okay, I'm not thinking about what God wants me to do and how I can do things for other people. If I'm angry with his, you know, I'm 2-3 hours into this, how I'm going to get even with him. I can't stand him. I hate him. You know, ooh, you know, I've run through red lights, and you know, because I'm thinking of how I'm going to get even with him and stupid stuff like that. But that's the whole idea also behind fears. I must be free of these fears. I make the list to first see what it is that I have to be free of. I ask God to remove these fears from me. And the whole idea, actually, this, I believe, is the most important one. They're all important. Going out to the ninth step, amends, is where this other list has taken us. The harms done others and the harms done others sexually is going to go to 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. Those steps are for this list right here. To be free of guilt, remorse, and shame for what I've done to these people is why you go through this list that we're talking about today. But once again, I'm going to double back and just explain that the spiritual solutions were forgiveness for resentments. The spiritual solution for fear is faith in God. And it's a real simple process of just doing things for other people. I believe it explained that here. Here it is right here. If sex is very troublesome, this is on page 70. Just turn to the next page there. 70, it's talking about the harms done others list again. If sex is very troublesome, we throw ourselves the harder into helping others. We think of their needs and work for them. This takes us out of ourselves. That's the whole idea behind the fears list there. The fears, the freedom from fears is to simply do things for other people. Because when I'm doing things for other people, it takes me out of myself. I'm not thinking about, if I'm sitting there thinking, okay, what can I do for the people in the AA meeting, I'm going to come in here and I'm going to do my best to try to explain these steps to you, and I'm going to open up the book and I'm going to show you where it says, what it says, and try to explain it how the guys explained it to me as best I can. Therefore, I can tell you that while I'm doing this, I'm not sitting up here thinking about myself and my selfish problems and my selfish wants and stuff like that. That's how the whole idea behind being free of fear is, that I think about other people and do things for other people, and it's the self-centered fears that we're talking about here. The fears that I won't get what I want, the fears that I'm going to lose what I have, and you can almost lump all the other fears into one of those two categories, basically. But those self-centered fears begin to go away. It says that once we commence to outgrow fear. We asked him to remove our fear. The spiritual solution for fear is faith in God, and here's the process of faith. We asked him to remove our fear and direct our attention to what he would have us be. At once we commenced to outgrow fear. And that's it's real simple. There's nothing complicated about this. And once again, you have to... I tell all my sponsees, look, you have to do this in order to get what it is. You can't hear me come up here and explain it. You got to go out and try it. And you got to go out and do things and think about other people. And then when someone sets something down in front of you and says, here, have a drink or have a blast of this, you react sanely and you go, no, I don't think so. Instead of the, just one, nobody will know. Where that comes from is that's the alcoholic insanity that we're going to be free of when we get to the point of doing this inventory on a daily basis. Out of nowhere, that voice that used to tell me, no one's going to know, just goes away. And all of a sudden it says, I'll know, and God'll know, and I don't want it. No thanks. And then like an hour later, I look back on it and I go, wow, what happened? How did I get out of there? I have no idea. I think I'm going to go to an AA meeting and get it back into this book and find out what the hell happened to me, okay? So that's pretty much why I'm sitting up here, because when you're not thinking about yourself, then the fears that drove me to drink are no longer at the level required for me to reach for that drink. And that's how it works. Joe and Charlie had this little thermometer of fear, and they handed it out to everybody, and they said, when you're doing things that bring the level of that fear, all those fears that are in my life, the self-centered fears, come down to this level that is no longer overpowering. Someone once said that there's the fear that's going to keep you from drinking and the fear that's going to make you drink, okay? And eventually that fear that keeps me from drinking will go away, and it better be replaced by faith, otherwise I'm going to drink. That's a real complex statement there, but it's real easy to understand that once you get into these steps and you start doing this thing. So, once again, this is not just a list of harms done others sexually. This is a list of harms done others other than sexually also. And the questions to answer are, where had I been selfish and dishonest? And that's where I'm going to find what is outlined in the 10th and the 11th step. You know, I took you out to the 10th step and showed you that, but I didn't take you to the 11th step because it says the same four things: resentment, fear, selfishness, and dishonesty. Those four things, the four common manifestations of self. Step 11, where it says this, is on page 86, right after step 10, of course. Right at the top right there, they're telling us to do our inventory every day, which is something that I had heard out of the corner of my ear one time. I heard somebody say that the 11th step inventory, and I go, uh-oh, now there's another one. I heard about the 4th step inventory and then the 10th step inventory, and now somebody's bringing up this 11th step. I think it took me a couple of years before that even registered, but right here is the 11th step inventory right in the beginning here. 86, when we retire at night, which is what I was told was the directions for when to do this. When to do the 11th step inventory, which is the exact same inventory of the 4th step and the 10th step, when we retire at night. I even have 11 p.m., which I believe Joe and Charlie said. One of them whispered out at 11 p.m., like we're supposed to be going to bed by 11, you know. When we retire at night, we constructively review our day. Were we resentful, selfish, dishonest, or afraid? Do we owe an apology? 8 and 9, that was step 4. Were we resentful, selfish, dishonest, or afraid? Do we owe an apology? 8 and 9. Have we kept something to ourselves which should be discussed with another person? Step 5. So in step 11, they're also telling us that there's really only 4 things we need to worry about. These are, you know, I heard somebody say this too. I heard somebody say, there may very well be hundreds of defects of character, as you've heard in meetings. I've heard it too. I've got hundreds of defects of character. And I go, jeez, man, you really just have a problem. I mean, I'm only worried about these 4. But what someone said was, that's right, we may have hundreds of defects of character, but we're only concerned with these 4 biggest ones, okay? These are the biggies, okay? These, and you can almost lump any one, the majority of those hundreds, maybe not all of them, but the majority of those hundreds of defects of character may very well fall into one of these 4 categories: resentful, selfish, dishonest, or afraid. One of those 4 categories is where all them defects will fall into. So, We're only looking for four, and this list finds the two of them, okay? This is the harms done others sexually and the harms done others list. We're going to answer these questions to find where had we been selfish and dishonest or inconsiderate, whom had we hurt, the names of the people for the eight-step list, did we unjustifiably arouse jealousy, suspicion, or bitterness, where were we at fault, what should we have done instead? That's a good one. That's probably one of the hardest ones for me to come up with. If I had known what I should have done instead, I probably would have done it anyway. You know, I probably would have done it. Well, we got this all down on paper and looked at it. That's the third time in the fourth step it says we got it all down on paper and looked at it. Once was the resentment list, once was the fears list, and once is this, the harms done others, and the harms done others sexual list. Now remember, what it said about resentments, it said, for when harboring such feelings... This is on 66 in the middle of the page there. Part of the prelude to how to be free of resentments. It says, for when harboring such feelings, we shut ourselves off from the sunlight of the Spirit, the insanity of alcohol returns, and we drink again. And with us to drink is to die. Once again, there's something that's keeping us from blocking. There's something that's blocking us from doing God's will. This is the list to find what it is that's blocking us from doing God's will. And in this list of selfishness and dishonesty is not really what's blocking us from doing God's will. It's not what we're trying to be free of. I mean, we're not going to go out and say, well, I'm going to stop being selfish and stop being dishonest. What we're going to do is we're going to make amends for these harms done others. Okay? The idea is that the spiritual solution for harms done others and harms done others sexually is the ninth step amends. You have to go all the way out to the ninth step, which is really right around the corner. All them other steps are on like one page. Well, except for five. Five is about four pages long, I think it is. But six, seven, eight, and nine are basically on one page. And that's how simple they really are. Because step six is speaking in a past tense, something you've already done. And step eight is speaking in a past tense. They're just acknowledging something that you've already done. When you get to step six, it says, we're entirely ready to have God remove all these defects of character. And I heard somebody say, this is the step that separates the boys from the men. And when they said that, I go, okay, so what does that mean? And then I heard somebody say, that's not what that means. I don't know where they came up with that crap, but this is what step six means. It's so simple. It says, as a result of the first five steps, we were entirely ready to have God remove these defects of character. What defects of character? Resentment, fear, selfishness, dishonesty. And once again, I don't remember who it was. I think it was Joe and Charlie that said that he's speaking of the same thing in every one of those steps. I used to look at him when I was new in sobriety, and I thought, oh my God, it just keeps getting bigger and bigger the further you go on down. This is a monster, this sobriety thing. It's just too much. And then I looked at it, and somebody said, no, in step four, he's saying you make an inventory of those four things. In step five, he says you told somebody about those four things. In step six, it says you're entirely ready to have God remove those four things. In step seven, it says you humbly asked Him to remove those four things. It's the simplest thing in the world. Yet, I was in meetings and no one knew what the hell they were talking about. And it took me years to come to this, I gotta tell you. Even the guy who took me through the steps didn't do it like I'm doing it here. He had me do it and never actually explained it to me. He said, oh, did you get it all? Yeah, it's done. Because he had hundreds of guys. I mean, he was one of them guys who literally had a line waiting to talk to him in every meeting he went to. And we would have this allotted time, each and one of us. Your night is Tuesday from 8 to 8:30, and your night is Tuesday from 8:30 to 9 o'clock. So I really didn't blame him for not explaining it to me. Because I could have went to meetings that were like, had smart people and devoted. I'm sure they were there. I mean, I wasn't at them. That's all there was to it. I was going to meetings where everybody complained about everything a lot. You know, oh, my roommate stole my wallet and he's drinking my sodas. And boy, what a meeting. Whew. Anyway, so the spiritual solutions are the most important thing to remember about the fourth step, is that this is not just an effort to find these things, it's an effort to face and be rid of them, to be free of resentments. To put me in a much better place to be thinking and doing things for other people. To be free of fears is to put me in a much better place to be thinking and doing things for other people. And to be free of this is the key point here, the ninth step is to be free of guilt, remorse, and shame for what it is that I've done. It doesn't really say that, but I've come to know that this is the result. They just tell you to do this. They tell you to do four, and then they tell you to share it with somebody in five, and step six is speaking in a past tense, saying that you were entirely ready to have God remove these. Step seven is a prayer. You asked Him to remove them. Step eight was that one sentence that says, in the past tense, once again, we made a list. We made it when we took our inventory. We have this list. We made it when we took our inventory, and that's step eight. Speaking in a past tense, something that you've already done. Simply acknowledging something that you've already done, and then step nine is you go out and make these amends. And I've heard many different takes on making amends, and the best one I've come across is you will never finish making amends. All you can do is start on it, and know that even somebody that you've made amends to, you're going to spend the rest of your life making amends. Just showing them that you, look, I'm sorry for what I've done. It sounds like this. I'm sorry for what I've done, and I will make sure that it never happens again. And I'm going to stay on top of this thing, and I'm going to try to thank and do things for, you know, the people that are in my life. And I'm going to show them through my actions this stuff. I'm not just talking, blowing smoke out my butt here. But so the idea behind step nine, and it doesn't say this anywhere, is that you're going to make amends. And why am I making amends? There's something going on here. I'm making amends because guilt, remorse, and shame is something that I'm carrying around with me. I had no idea. If somebody had told me, look, you feel guilty for what you've done to these people. You stole from your parents, for God's sakes. You lied to them and you stole a car and didn't come back for a week or whatever, you know. Took their gold chains or something stupid. Something. Oh, no, I didn't see it. Let me help you look for it. Whatever it was that I did to hurt those people, I had no idea that I felt real guilty about doing that to them. And I always thought, you know, when I saw that movie, The Terminator, that was me, man. I said, that is me. I'm a metal skeleton underneath. I don't feel no pain. I was carrying that thing around on my back like a sack of 80 pounds of rocks. And I didn't know that until I had made some amends to some of the closest people to me. I actually told them I was sorry, and I said what I said tonight. I will make sure that this never happens again. I guarantee you that I will never take another drink as long as I live. If I do, I'm going to put a bullet through my head, and that's all there is to it. That's how. This is life and death for me. I don't know about you. There ain't no, I'm going to go out and drink, and I'll come back and pick up a white chip. No, this is life and death, and that's all there's. I've noticed that about a lot of people who've stayed sober for long periods of time. They feel the same. This is not, you know, just, ooh, it's, maybe I'll get sober, maybe I'll go have a drink, maybe, okay, I'll go hang out in AA. No, this is it, man. I came in here on my knees, and I was done. And that's how I've heard a lot of people who've stayed sober for long periods of time. They felt the same way, you know. I'm not saying that you won't get sober without that, but I think that it helps. It really, because it makes you willing to do whatever you have to do. I have the willingness to go through this and do it and stay on top of it forever from now on. But the spiritual solutions, there's three of them now, okay? And those are really the whole basis of the program of Alcoholics Anonymous. In order to do things for other people, I have to be rid of this selfishness. I must, or it kills me, is what it says here. And these are the four common manifestations of self. And to be rid of selfishness and dishonesty, you have to go all the way out to the ninth step and see the amends. I make amends for what I've done to clear away my guilty conscience. Because when harboring those feelings, they're blocking me off from the sunlight of the Spirit. I'm feeling guilty, remorseful, and shameful for the lying to those people and stealing from them and the treating them the way I did. And I got to show them that I'm sorry and tell them that I'm sorry. Show them through my actions, not just, you know, the boy that cried wolf, oh, I'll never do it again. Somebody brought that up once. Just telling people that I was sorry. I've been doing that for years. I did that for years and went out and drank the next day. Oh, I'm sorry, it'll never happen again. I was drunk the next night. So the boy that cried, it took people, all the people in my life, it took them about 3 or 4 years before they finally said, you know what, I think he's serious about this stuff. Something's changing with this guy. But, that's about how long it took for people to believe that I was serious about this. 3 or 4 years. As sad as that may be. But that was just because I was my own fault. You know, I told people I was sorry and went out and did it again. I'll tell you I'm sorry next week when I do it again. You know, it didn't work that way. But, so the spiritual solution of forgiveness, faith in God, and amends. Those are our three spiritual solutions here that we offer. And, that's pretty much it. I mean, it's not a complicated list. The questions that you need to answer are right there with your question marks. Whom had we hurt? The names of those people. And like I said, it's real simple. My first sponsor, I didn't even know what I was doing. He just said, I want you to go home and write down a list of everybody in your family. Start off with all your closest members of your family and then all your girlfriends and all your employers and coworkers, and just make a big long list of these people's names. I go, okay. I went home and I made all this list. And then he said, now I want you to write down what you did to each one of them. And that's what he had me do. You know, I stole from this one. I lied to that one. I cheated this one. Mostly it was a lot of lying and stealing, I got to tell you. So we got this all down on paper and looked at it, and then we go out to step 9 and we make amends for what we've done. And the idea is that when I'm free of these selfish things and I go all the way out to step 11 and look what it says, I make this inventory when I retire at night and I turn to God and I say, what do you want me to do? And the whole idea is that the answers that come into my head when I ask God, what do you want me to do, are much less likely to sound like steal their car or lie to them, cheat them out of something. It's more likely to sound like, you know, do something for somebody and don't expect anything in return. Selflessly do things for other people, and I feel real good about who I am. And they say it's an inside job, and that's the whole idea behind it, is I feel good about who I am. And when someone says, here, Doug, you want a drink? I go, no, I feel pretty good. I feel good about who I am and what I'm doing in life. And it's so much easier for me to say, no, I don't touch that stuff. None for me, thanks. Anyway, that's the way sobriety works for me. That's the process of learning how to have faith in God. I don't know how else to put it other than to say that, you know, I don't think it's something that resides in the other world. This faith that we speak of here in Alcoholics Anonymous, for me, it does not reside in the other world type thing. It's not a ghost, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit and all that stuff. It's right here and now in this world. And that's how it works. I feel good about who I am. I react sanely when someone offers me a drink, and I have faith that it works, and that's all there is to it. With that, we're going to pass the baskets. And next week we'll do step 5, and pretty much when I do step 5, I'm just going to review 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and because 5 is real simple. Yeah, you got a question, bud?
No, not a question. It's like, you're the most amazing share I've ever seen up there before. You know the steps better than anybody that I've ever seen. And I can only wish to have a sponsor that knows me.
Yeah, get with me after the meeting, Chief. Okay, can we have a volunteer for the chips tonight?
Well, we have a chip system in Florida. The bottom line, first chip's a white chip. You pick it up if you have a desire to stop drinking. Does anybody have a desire to stop drinking? No? 30 days is silver. The other is 60 days. Everybody's seen it. Red's 90. Blue 6 months, and the pretty purple is 9 months. No, if you haven't had, if you got a year or more, you put your name on the board. We celebrate the last Sunday of the month, 7, with cake and ice cream and all that. And if you haven't had a birthday, they don't.
Okay, we'll do step 5 next week. And once again, this. very simple. The hard part is you have to do it. That's why so few people make it. Anyway, could I please have 15 volunteers clean up after the meeting? Anonymity is the spiritual foundation of all of our traditions, ever reminding us to place principles before personalities, which is our 12th tradition, and means exactly what it says. We'll close the meeting. Somebody changed everything. Hey, Fred. Do what? Not all of a sudden. I mean, that gradual thing, you know.
Gradually. They could have changed a few pages.
They could have, like, changed the top half and then left the bottom alone. And then I don't even recognize it. I'm going to wing it. Facilitate the reading of the Roman numeral and the first 164 pages of Alcoholics Anonymous sequentially over the course of weeks. Yeah, right. They're telling you how to do it. I mean, they did that to me before. So I came in here and he goes, when you chair the meeting, you got to do this. I go, you know what? I think I'll just take my name off the board and you can chair the meeting. He goes, oh, no. Well, okay, you go ahead and do what you want to do. I go, that's pretty much what I had in mind, yeah.
That control issue.
What are we reading?
Step four.
Okay.
Harms done others.
I just didn't know if I was so sure.
International Convention Opening Flag Ceremony. Somebody turn the air conditioner off. Yeah. It's too quiet for an air conditioner to be running. Huh?
And they moved it.
I tell you what, if it's too hot in here, you'll find me at another meeting.
It is too hot.
I ain't gonna play it. Homie don't play that.
I don't feel that.